Geelong built on its impressive semi-final record, undeterred by the events of the previous week, straightening a whole lot out and moving through to a preliminary final and awaiting Melbourne, who are refreshed. That powerful qualifying final win earning the short way home, and now they are about to convene in Perth on Friday night. You'll see it all on Fox. The coverage will start at 6:30. It's got main event written all over it, Jason. The two coaches are with us. Simon Goodwin, welcome back to 360.
Evening, Jared. Evening, Jase. Good to be on.
Chris Scott, great to have you back.
Good to be here. Good to see you guys.
I know you'll both be desperate to talk specifics and tactics and workshop everything that's going to take place. Maybe we could start a little more broadly. Simon, you played in five preliminary finals. You've had a taster as one as a coach. Just what's the magnitude of a prelim as you came to know it?
Oh, I think it comes together with everything that you've been working on. You know, they're the biggest games of the year and they give you the maximum opportunity. And I think at this time of year, it's really about executing and building clarity in how you want to play and how you want to perform. But, you know, being able to execute it under the ultimate pressure, and that's what it is. It's, you know, there's a pressure that builds and you know, you've got to perform and you've got to execute at this time of year. So it's something we've worked on for a long time. We're looking forward to it. But, you know, they're tough games to win and we know the quality of opponent we're up against.
You spoke about pressure there, Goody. This is a question for both you and Chris. Players, when they talk about stepping up from home and away to final, say it's a bit quicker, you've got less time to get rid of the ball and you're sort of sucking in breath for the first 10 or 15 minutes. Is it the same when you're coaching or is it just like any other game in the coach's box?
You go, Scotty. Is that me or Scotty?
Yeah. Okay. I know, I think it's very different. I've found very little connection between coaching and playing. I think the circumstances are different. Certainly from a playing perspective, I can completely, I can remember really clearly how quickly the game goes in finals, probably grand finals more than anything. Whereas a coach, I think it's the opposite. The minutes tend to go very slowly, especially when you're in front.
What about you, Goody?
Yeah, look, I tend to agree with Scotty. You know, it is a different experience as a player and as a coach, you know, you do a lot of preparation, you get all the you know, what you want to do and how you want to do it, but the game does seem to go for a long time. You know, you got to win it multiple times and you know, the momentum swings of the game are really important. So you certainly feel all of that. There's no doubt about that.
So, Chris, are prelims in a genre of their own? You played in three and you're about to coach in your seventh.
Did I only play in three?
I've got you down as three. You skipped over one and went straight to a grand final, one year.
I'm a bit disappointed in that. I thought I was more experienced. They do sit by themselves. Obviously, the grand final is a pinnacle and that's the one everyone wants to get to. But I think most years the best teams get to preliminary final weekend. It's very unusual to see teams that are, you know, entrenched in the top four to get knocked out before this round. So you just know they're always going to be high-quality games, a whole lot at stake. I hear some people say they can get more anxious and nervous about a prelim final than they do about a grand final. I can understand that to some extent.
Have you ever found that?
Yeah, I have. Especially as a younger player when you hadn't done it. Too often, it is rarefied air, and it can. I think it's probably as much as anything when you get to this stage of the year, the sense that if you can't deliver, you know, how bad you're going to feel, and probably more than that, how long it is to get back to that position. It's very rare that you come away thinking, oh, well, you know, we had a shot at it, but we'll be better for it next year. You more think about it's 12 long months of hard work just to give yourself another chance.
So, Simon, you build for it, you plan for it, you live for it. Will you lose sleep for it this week?
I think as a coach, you're always losing sleep. You know, I think Scotty touched on a really good point. They're hard games to get to and you work incredibly hard to get to the position you're in. And now it's about really maximising your opportunities. So, you know, as a coach, you want to make sure you get everything right in place. You know, your team's in a good mindset and you're ready to go. And, you know, we certainly feel as a footy club, we've got a lot of pieces in the right places. And we feel well prepared, but that doesn't mean you sleep any better. You know, things happen in games and you need a little bit of luck. And as I said, we know the opposition we're up against, they're high quality, and the games between the two teams have been very close over a number of years now.
So you've spoken about 2018 and the first experience and how different a team this is now and the accrual of experience along the way. Is it worth anything to you come this week, 3 years on?
I think it's worth in terms of the build-up and the foundations that have been laid. You know, we're a lot more consistent in how we play. We've got a clear brand of what we stand for and how we go about our footy. And, we're incredibly hard to play against. And, I think that's why we've been able to put ourselves in the position we're in. So we're a lot sounder in the foundations of how we play. And that certainly builds belief within the playing group. But the experience of 2018 is certainly not lost on a lot of guys. You know, that was... You know, a few years ago now, but it was the first time that the club had played finals for 11 years. And, we found ourselves pretty quickly in a prelim. So we get back here in better shape and better health and, you know, our game's in better order.
Keen to talk about the selection process with both coaches. I'll start with you, Chris. I guess when you've won a final, apart from injury or having a really good player to come back, you wouldn't think there's going to be a lot of changes. Does it become a little bit easier now with selection?
I never find selection easy, Jace. It's especially at this time of year. And we have, over the journey, tended to make, we haven't been afraid to make changes, but we'd prefer stability towards the end of the year. There's no doubt about that. Ideally, you're playing really good footy with a group of players and you just keep rolling on. But we've got the obvious change to make this year in this week in Brandon Parfitt, who's got that really serious hamstring issue. So we'll be making at least one change, but I think the guys that got it done last week, and there are reasons probably why we didn't pick certain guys in previous weeks that are just in better shape now. So we've got more confidence now than we did, say, a few weeks ago.
And what about you, Goody? I mean, you've got so many peripheral players there that are busting to try and force their way in. Where are the opportunities for them to do that?
Yeah, look, we had a really strong match simulation on Friday, and you know, a lot of the guys that you're speaking about, you know, Nathan Jones, Mogulhibber, Jake Melksham, all put their hands up for selection in terms of how they went about it. So, yeah, we've got some decisions to make, but you know, this time of year, you're pretty stable, you build cohesion, so that you don't see a lot of change. But in saying that, those guys are pushing pretty hard, and you know, some of those changes, if they are made, will be based on opposition, but we have, you know, enormous belief in the group that we've got playing as well.
Have any of those individuals knocked on the coach's door, maybe coming up with a specific role they think they could play, Goody?
Yeah, there's plenty of them. There's been a lot of conversations over a few games of cards this week about where they sit and how they're going about their footy. So, I think, you know, everyone wants to play this time of year. It's why you play footy. It's to be involved in finals footy and to play in the ultimate games. And, so they're all eager to play. There's no doubt about that.
What dynamic have you gone for in quarantine, Simon? Have you gone for school camp, Olympic Village? What have you chimed for to pass the time?
Oh, the first two or three days, we kept it really relaxed away from footy. Obviously, 2 weeks before your next game, we wanted to get away from the game a little bit. So we embraced that. We played some different games in and around our playing group. There's no doubt there's a group that are playing cards, there's a group that are gaming, but you know, come Friday, that's just gone. We had a really solid match simulation, and you know, as we build now, our hub's starting to really focus around our purpose and our ability to get our week right heading into this weekend's game. So it's a unique situation, being in a hub and being on top of each other with some time away from the game, but the guys have embraced that. You know, Choco produced a pretty good quiz night the other night, which was full of humour and entertainment with the younger players. So, that brings a bit of light to the group.
Scotty, you said you're not afraid to make changes. You brought Radaglia back into the lineup. Five possessions, kicked a goal, but he was able to give some good chop out to Reece Stanley in the ruck. Did that work out the way you wanted it to?
Yeah, we think it did, Jace. We didn't say it at the time. I tend not to be as transparent as one could be around these sort of things. But a few weeks ago, he just wasn't in the... he had a little bit of an injury issue that left him sort of less than his best. And we just think he's the sort of player that needs to be really firing in terms of his health and his fitness to play well. And he's found that now. And I've always been encouraged around the sort of player that he could be and the sort of role he can play for us. So that's a pretty good endorsement.
You must be thrilled that the group's not relying on a Selwood or a Dangerfield to drag them over the line. That's something to me that really looks like it's there's almost been a transition there in terms of other players carrying the load. Is that how you're seeing it?
Yeah, I think it's a pretty good observation, but it's not just limited to those guys. I mean, even if you look at this year in isolation, Dangerfield probably missed half the year at a guess, Cameron about the same, Mitch Duncan half the year, Tom Stewart's out of the team. You know, even Parfa going out, who's been a mainstay of our midfield. I think what we have shown over the last year or two is the capacity to cover those guys. And, you know, it gets harder as you get towards the end of the year because, for obvious reasons, you know, you're playing the best teams. So I think having a really consistent group of players that, you know, can cover for each other if one's not firing is important at this time of year. And I think both teams, to be honest, you know, have been able to develop that this year.
You have just played. It was wild, round 23. It thrilled all of us on the outside. I know you'll be really thrilled to answer this particular question. Simon, what's the relevance of round 23 for you heading towards a prelim against the same opponent?
Oh, I think the relevance for us is that we know that we're playing a quality opposition. And, you know, clearly we'll take some learnings out of the game. There's periods of the game where Geelong were on top and there were periods of the game where we had some dominance as well. So all it does is reaffirm the challenge that we've got in front of us this week. And as I said, the history between the two teams clearly indicate that it's going to be close. And, you know, we're looking forward to that. But, you know, we took some learnings out of the game, but it's really not relevant now. It's relevant who performs best and who executes best come Friday night.
Did the player, or were the players able to watch the game together, Goody, on the weekend?
Yeah, well, we left up the players. You know, we had it on in the common room. There was a group of players that were watching it there, and there were other groups of guys that, you know, watched it within their room. So we really left it up to the playing group about what they wanted to do, and you know, each individual chose, you know, the direction they wanted to take. Some guys are really involved and want to watch a lot of footy. Others don't want to watch too much. So it's a really individualised thing. And, you know, as I said, we're really focused on now our game and how we prepare and how we have the purpose leading into the game.
How do you study, Chris, round 23 a few weeks on?
Well, I think it's relevant because it was so recent. It was a strange game for a number of reasons. I mean, there wasn't the incentive of the home final, although that's hopefully not the reason we played so poorly in the second half. But I think, you know, Goody made the obvious point, which is both teams would have a level of respect for each other out of that game, but also know that if they get things on their terms, they're capable of sort of playing all over the top of the other. It was weird too. There was no spectators there. I think both teams would be relishing getting to a, you know, pretty full Optus Stadium. There's some parts that are relevant, but the specifics. I don't think we'll be focusing too much on whatever it was 4 or 5 weeks ago, because prelim finals, as you said, tend to be a bit different.
Chris, Simon, stay with us. We'll pick up in a few moments' time our conversation on coaches' nights, and then in a few minutes' time, we'll be off with Couch as Jared Healy, Gary Lyon, Jonathan Brown and Nick Revolt take you through the events of the weekend as they saw them and set you up for the prelims to come.
The Moment, brought to you by PointsBet.
It was a momentous night in Geelong history on Friday nights as Joel Selwood eclipsed Corey Enright as the game's record holder. So 333 and continuing on, shared off by Tom Hawkins, who shared a great many of those, and Corey Enright, who's lived the whole journey with Joel and now one of his coaches. So for not just a semi-final, but a true moment in club history, as Joel will set a record that'll be fearsomely hard to run down. Chris, did the club do anything? Were you able to do anything to mark such an occasion?
Well, we're all together, Jared, so that helped a little bit. We didn't do anything too formal, but we've obviously had some challenges over the last 18 months, but one of the silver linings has been the amount of time that we've been able to spend together as a group. We feel fortunate that we've got our whole list over here, albeit in quarantine in Perth, but it was just fantastic for some of those younger guys to get a sense of how lucky we all are to be a part of the Geelong Footy Club. And that club's history spanned 162 years, and we have the previous games record holder in our coaching group and the current gold games record holder as our captain. It's just a reminder of how privileged we are to be in this position.
Chris, I think I asked you a couple of weeks ago about a particular milestone. You said you do like celebrating, but it feels like Geelong's been celebrating milestones all year. There's been one after another. But I want to ask you something specifically about Joel Selwood. Is he the sort of player that you look at and think he'd be a good coach? I know he's a lot of footy still to play, but is he one of those that you think, yeah, he'll go down the coaching path?
I don't have any doubt that he's got the capability. I mean, in some ways, he reminds me a little bit of Lee Matthews in that I didn't know for sure that Lee Matthews was a great coach before he got to Brisbane, but his reputation preceded him.
Yep.
And he just commanded respect by virtue of his actions on field. And I don't think even opposition supporters, I imagine, you know, deep down, you can't help but have respect for the way Joel's gone about it. And the part that they don't see and the part that we really admire, you know, aside from the on-field stuff, he's a really caring teammate. He works well across the group, and I think that will hold him in good stead as a coach if he chooses to go down that path.
Simon, your fan base is such a part of this journey through the final series back in Melbourne. Have you been able to get any feel yet in Perth? How many Melbourne supporters are there over in WA?
We're feeling there's a few. There's no question about that. And we certainly feel for our supporters back in Melbourne. You know, they've waited a long time to come to the MCG and watch their team in you know, really important finals. But, you know, we can certainly feel their support from here, and we can certainly feel the support building in Perth. You know, we've been inundated with messages. I know we've been running some clinics online with a few of the players, and there's definitely a lot of support out there. The players are feeling that, and they just want to do their very best and make everyone that's supporting Melbourne really proud. So we can feel it. We can feel the support building in Perth, and we want to embrace the Perth people.
Question for both gentlemen, and I guess it comes from a different perspective, though. The bye after this week, should you be successful? I guess for you, Goody, first up, you go bye, game, bye, then grand final. Does that suit, or would you prefer a little bit more momentum?
Oh, it's a good problem to have, Jase. There's no doubt about that. It is unique. You know, we haven't experienced that before, but you know, that's where you lean on your high performance manager, Darren Burgess, and his team to build the program, and that's what training's for, to prepare ourselves as best for what the game demands. And you know, it'll be a good problem to have if we're lucky enough and fortunate enough to be in that situation, and one we'll do our very best to get right.
And what about you, Scotty? Is it a week that you think would benefit the club should you win this week?
I think the obvious specific there is Tom Stewart's situation. So we appreciate that the bye is there to give him a chance to come back, and where our early indication, I guess, is that he's still a real chance. So we prefer to have it rather than not. But I think in the broader context, the approach of the last 2 years just has to be that this is a very strange situation, and he's just got to roll with the punches. I'd be surprised if any club in the AFL or the sporting world in general hasn't taken that approach, because if you I think if you're not prepared for the curveballs that might come by now, you never will be.
Chris, Simon, thanks for your time, and the very best of luck come Friday night.
Thanks, guys.
These conversations will last all week, and they'll pick up at 6:30 on Friday night in particular, and zero right in on the opening siren. Players' night on 360 tomorrow night. Ollie Wines from a Port perspective, Christian Petrarca back over in Perth, and Jack Revolt, who knows a thing or two about this time of year.